بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. طبعا أنا سعيد جدا بوجود الصحبة الجميلة جدا من مصر ومن الدول العربية. معنا الدكتور رياض سعيد والدكتور سعيد والدكتور فيصل شاهين من يعني الدكتور رياض من الأردن والدكتور فيصل من السعودية وحشد طبعا من مصر ومن الإسماعيلية ومن جميع المدن. فطبعا النهاردة هتبقى محاضرة متميزة جدا. الدكتور منتصر زيد طبعا هو أستاذ بجامعة اسكندرية ومن الناس اللي لها معزة طبعا في قلوبنا جميعا وبنعرفه من سنوات طويلة جدا. فهو أستاذ في جامعة اسكندرية وما زال لغاية النهاردة رغم أنه وصل لسن المعاش ما يبانش عليه طبعا ما بنحسدوش لكن وما زال مش حضرتك دكتور منتصر لسه ماسك الترانسبلانتيشن مش كده؟ دكتور منتصر دكتور منتصر الصوت عنده رايح. فدكتور منتصر ما يعني
دكتور حسين
الترانسبلانتيشن سيرفيس في اسكندريه حضرتك لسه رئيسها لغايه دلوقتي
لسه ستيل يعني هيد اوف كيدني ترانسبلانت يونت في المواساه يونيفرسيتي هوسبيتال
ربنا
نسبايت ان انا ستيل يعني ناو
امرتس لا الصوت
بروفيسور في الانترنال ميديسن في الكيبنج مي بلانت يونت اللي انا انشاتها سنه 2015.
حضرتك قرب من الكمبيوتر لان الصوت بيروح. طبعا الدكتور منتصر حبيبنا كلنا ولو اتشيفمنت طبعا كاستاذ سوبرفايزنج ماسترز اند ام دي ديجريز ورئيس المنتديات وميتنج والوحده. احنا بنسعد جدا بالدكتور منتصر وده كان احد النفرو اليكس مع استاذ الدكتور صلاح نجا وده في نيفرو أليكس في 2017 في حشد من الحاضرين من هنا الدكتور منتصر في القلب هو طبعا جنب الدكتور صبح ودي مجموعة تانية برضو دايما بنسعد بوجوده. السنة اللي فاتت في ديسمبر أو في نوفمبر 2019 كان عندنا الكورس للأفارقة والدكتور منتصر فاجئنا مفاجأة كبيرة جدا انه جاب معاه أحد الزملاء من اسكندرية يترجم من انجليزي الفرنساوي لان احنا كان عندنا ترجمه فوريه كمساعده وكانت المحاضره بتاعته عنوانها رينا ريبليسمنت ثيرابي ان ذا اي سي يو وفي وجود الدكتور سمير كان رئيس السيشن دي. دايما ده طبعا هنا كوكبه في مؤتمر اللي نظمه الدكتور كمال عكاشه نفر طنطا طبعا الدكتور مي والدكتور عمرو حسين والدكتور صلاح ناجا وطبعا هنا الدكتور روبرت نجم والدكتور جمال السعدي. فطبعا كلنا بنعتز. طبعا الدكتور سعيد خميس جبت له الصورة ديت وفي الماندو في جامعة المنصورة طبعا كنا سعداء جدا بوجود الدكتور منتصر وادى محاضرة الأكيوت كيدني انجري السنة اللي فاتت. طبعا هنا دكتور علاء دكتور غادة الدكتور محمد كمال نصار وكل فريق المنصور. دكتور منتصر بالنسبة للـ ESNT فيرتشوال أكاديمي ما أعتقدش إن حدا تعرف المعلومة دي إن ده ليك 33 محاضرة موجودين كسورسز موجودة على الـ ESNT فيرتشوال أكاديمي وثلاث فيديوهات وده احد الفيديوهات اهيت وده الفيديو الثاني والفيديو الثالث في وده كان اخر
واقع يعني العدد ده
وده كان اخر فيديو السنه في الترانسبلانت شابتر ترانسبلانتيشن كانت ديبيت مع دكتور اشرف فوده على الترانسبلانتيشن الاتيبيكال اتش او اس وده في مؤتمر الجمعيه. النهارده طبعا احنا في انتظار المحاضره المرتقبه للهيموداليس إمرجنسيز. طبعا الإمرجنسيز في الهيموداليس أشكال وألوان وصعب جدا أن يتغطى في وان بريزنتيشن ده محتاجة ولا 20 بريزنتيشن لكن أعتقد هناخد مقتطفات من أهم الهيموداليسيس إمرجنسيز اللي ممكن نقابلها في الهيموداليس. أنا بشكرك يا دكتور منتصر وأتمنى إن شاء الله تبقى حلقة موفقة للجميع بإذن الله. أنا هفتح لحضرتك التشير أهوت حضرتك تقدر تعمل شير سكرين دلوقتي.
ستيل ديسيبلد تيل نام
لا خلاص حضرتك خلاص شير اهي انا عاطي الالاونس للشير. اتفضل اتفضل يا باشا.
وانا لغايه دلوقتي بيطلع لي ان هو ديسيبلد انما يعني ها بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I would like to thank all my colleagues for their nice speech and nice introduction. And I will talk today about hemodialysis emergencies. My agenda today will include introduction, dialysis disequilibrium syndrome, embolism, hemolysis, venous needle dislodgement, allergic reactions during hemodialysis, emergencies related to dialysis water system, vascular access hemorrhage, and at the end, a root cause analysis after an adverse event. Small introduction about emergencies can be attributed to numerous safety features in modern dialysis machines, meticulous treatment and dialysis solution to prevent exposure to trace elements, toxins, and the pathogen pools will lead to decline in the number of hemodialysis emergencies encountered during hemodialysis. Most hemodialysis emergencies can be attributed to human error, and a smaller number are due to rare idiosyncratic reaction. The major hemodialysis emergencies are dialysis equilibrium, action, cardiac arrest, cardiac tamponade, intracranial hemorrhage, seizure, errors in following the hemodialysis prescription. The intradialytic complications of hemodialysis in acute and the chronic renal failure, hypertension cases, 6%. Acute and the chronic kidney, chronic renal failure patients, hypotension occurred in 30% in acute renal failure patients and 26% in chronic, nausea and vomiting in 26% in acute and 14% in chronic renal failure patients, fever and chills in 19% and 14% in chronic. Muscle cramps is more common in chronic renal failure patients than acute renal failure patients. First use syndrome is more common in acute than chronic. Hypertension is more common in chronic than acute. Intracerebral hemorrhage also is more common in chronic kidney disease patients than in acute. First, we should start by dialysis disequilibrium syndrome, which is a syndrome. It is a rare syndrome occurring in patients with severe azotemia undergoing their initial hemodialysis sessions. It is characterized by nausea, vomiting, headache, encephalopathy, and seizure. Dialysis disequilibrium syndrome is attributed to faster decline of urea concentration in blood than in brain during a dialysis session. This lag creates an osmotic gradient that leads to water shift from blood to brain, leading to cerebral edema and its associated manifestations. Rosen et al. Studied 10 patients with kidney injury baseline blood urea nitrogen concentration from 260 to 460 milligram per deciliter undergoing their initial hemodialysis session, and they obtained the concurrent plasma and cerebrospinal fluid CSF sample before dialysis and immediately after dialysis and 24 hours after dialysis. The CSF to plasma blood urea nitrogen ratio was 0.91 pre-dialysis, 1.99 immediately after dialysis, and back to baseline 24 hours later. Arif et al. Suggested that generation of new solutes, which is accounted for brain edema during rapid hemodialysis. Additional risk factors include pre-existing neurologic conditions, first time of hemodialysis, hyponatremia, and liver failure. It is unknown whether the risk of dialysis disequilibrium syndrome is similar in patients with advanced chronic kidney disease. It is unknown whether the risk of dialysis disequilibrium syndrome is similar in patients with advanced chronic kidney disease and those with acute kidney injury. But in my experience, it is more common in chronic kidney disease than in patients with acute kidney injury. Computed tomography or magnetic resonance may show cerebral edema in patients with dialysis disequilibrium syndrome. Bortitel reported that a higher dialysate sodium concentration, 144 to 154 millimore per liter, prevented dialysis disequilibrium syndrome. Each 1 millimole per liter increase in serum sodium offsets the effect of 12 milligram per deciliter blood urea nitrogen. The sodium modeling may be useful in dialysis disequilibrium syndrome during the initial hemodialysis sessions in patients at risk. Adding glucose or glycerol to dialysate may also prevent dialysis disequilibrium syndrome. Rodrigo et al. Studied patients on hemodialysis at risk for dialysis disequilibrium syndrome by adding glucose to the dialysate or administering intravenous mannitol, increasing dialysate glucose concentration to 450 milligram per deciliter, contributed 2 to 3 millimolar per kilogram water, whereas intravenous mannitol 1 gram per kilogram added 8.5 to 10 milliosmol per kilogram water. The potential strategies to prevent dialysis disequilibrium syndrome include limiting first hemodialysis session to 2 to 2.5 hours, limit blood flow to 200 to 250 milli per minute, sodium modeling or a high sodium dialysate, consider intravenous mannitol, consider continuous renal replacement therapy in patients at risk for dialysis disequilibrium syndrome, of course, for patients with acute kidney injury, suffering from traumatic brain injury, intracerebral hemorrhage, intracranial mass, and these are KDIGO recommendations. The second point will be discussed is air embolism. Venous air embolism during hemodialysis is thought to be rare, but because signs and symptoms of air embolism may mimic other more common complications, high suspicion is required for the diagnosis. Air bubbles trapped in systemic, pulmonary, or cerebral microcirculation may cause local ischemia, circulatory arrest, activation of complement and the coagulation system, localized inflammation, and vascular endothelial cell damage. Venous air embolism may arise from four possible areas of air entry into dialysis circuit: a broken lower lock connection between arterial needle and tubing can result in air entry because in this segment it is pre-blood pump, so it has a negative pressure, and this will lead to withdrawal of air into dialysis circuit. A hole in this arterial line can suck air into arterial line. Air entry also can occur during administration of anticoagulation or intravenous infusion of normal saline. Inadequate priming of the dialyzer also can result in air entry from the dialyzer or dialysis tubing system. Massive venous air embolism manifests with chest pain, dyspnea, and syncope. Cerebral air embolism may cause blurring of vision, altered mental status, seizure, or ischemic stroke. Patients may develop hypotension and tachycardia due to right ventricular overload with involvement of the pulmonary capillary bed. In dogs, rapid injection of 7.5 milli per kilogram air is lethal. In humans, a volume of 100 to 300 milli air is considered fatal precordial Doppler can detect as little as 0.05 milli per kilogram air. Transesophageal echo can detect as little as 0.02 milli per kilogram air. Computed tomography may detect air in suspected cases of cerebral air embolism. After venous air embolism is suspected, the patient should be provided with 100% oxygen. Aspiration of air may be attempted if catheter is still in place. Early studies suggest that left lateral recumbent position could prevent right ventricular failure by preventing outflow tract obstruction during air embolism by moving the air more superiorly in the right ventricle. During central venous catheter removal, the patient should be supine with catheter removed during exhalation or expiration or a valsalva maneuver to increase intrathoracic pressure. An air occlusive dressing should be in place for 24 hours to prevent delayed air entry through a subcutaneous tract after removal of the central venous catheter. Although traditional teaching has been to maintain left lateral recumbent position with head down for suspected venous air embolism, supine position has been recommended more recently. The supine position also provides additional advantage of appropriate delivery of oxygen and the hemodynamic support. Air embolism may occur during placement of a hemodialysis central venous catheter, accidental disconnection during its use or at its removal. The third issue in hemodialysis emergencies are hemolysis. And red cells undergo shear stress when they circulate through the hemodialysis circuit and are therefore at risk for fermentation. The low degree of hemolysis that typically occur during hemodialysis is insufficient to produce a measurable drop in hematocrit, and more significantly, hemolysis may occur in dialysate of contamination with copper, zinc, nitrate, nitrite, and chloramine, as will be mentioned later, hypoosmolar dialysate, hyperthermia, extracorporeal circuit related, as blood pump malocclusion, single needle high flow dialysis, partial occlusion of hemodialysis catheter, kinked tubes, and faulty blood tubing. Patient related factors, as in congenital hemolytic anemias, sickle cell anemia, thalassemia, hereditary spherocytosis, or autoimmune hemolysis. Actually, some cases of congenital hemolytic anemia are diagnosed late in life, not from childhood. If the hemodialysis machine triggers an alarm for overheated dialysate, an appropriate stepwise protocol should be followed. At first, respond to alarm. Immediate cessation of dialysis, inform concerned authorities. Alonso et al. Reported an issue with a valve system malfunction that led to heated dialysate of 39.8 and no harm to patient due to attentiveness of the nurse who followed an appropriate protocol. Overheated dialysate may cause thermal injury and hemolysis, and because modern hemodialysis machines trigger an alarm at dialysate temperature of more than 39.5, hyperthermic hemolysis is now very rare. Patients with severe intradialytic hemolysis complain of nausea, shortness of breath, abdominal back pain, and chills, and initially develop acute hypertension. Confirmatory laboratory data include low serum haptoglobin, elevated lactate dehydrogenase, reduction in hematocrit, and pink serum. When hemolysis is suspected, the hemodialysis session should be stopped immediately. Blood should not be returned from extracorporeal circulation to the bloodstream due to a high risk of precipitating severe hyperkalemia by infusing potassium released from hemolyzed erythrocytes. If several patients develop hemolysis in a single dialysis unit, contamination of the dialysate, faulty tubing, blood pump segment is not suitable for this type of machine, and alter the dialysate osmolality should be suspected. This is a schematic diagram illustrating an approach evaluation of a suspected case of hemolysis during hemodialysis and its root cause analysis to prevent further episodes. At first, stop dialysis. At first, stop dialysis, inform physician and the supervisor, don't return extracorporeal blood, lab sample for hemoglobin, LDH, potassium, haptoglobin type and cross-match, methemoglobin level in suspected cases, examine patient oxygen as needed, hemodynamic monitoring and support, alternative arrangement for another dialysis for session for the patient, document arterial and venous access pressure, evidence of kinked bend tubing, needle infiltration, blood pump malocclusion, check dialysate for temperature, conductivity, osmolality, culture, and sequester hemodialysis machine, save needle and tube system and dialyzer, inform biomedical team for assessment of hemodialysis machine and tubing, and review, watch for cluster of similar events in unit, review dialysis machine log, review chlorine check log from machine and the carbon tank, and check recent trace element values. After that, we shall talk about venous needle dislodgement, which is a rare but life-threatening complication of hemodialysis. With a typical dialysis blood flow of 300 to 400 milli per minute, hemorrhagic shock will occur within minutes after loss of 30 to 40% of total blood volume. Two large Canadian series of patients on home dialysis reported venous needle dislodgement in one in 11,000. Ideally, to ensure early detection of blood loss, the venous pressure alarm would be set 10 millimercury below the baseline dialysis venous pressure. RedSense is a device developed for detection of blood leakage for in-center and home hemodialysis. It consists of an alarm unit connected by an optical fiber to a sensor patch, which is put over the venous needle. When blood comes in contact with the optical sensor in the patch, it generates a continuous alarm. The major factors leading to needle dislodgement are related to access curve, improper taping of excess tubing to skin. Proper taping is seen in this figure. Loose lure lock tubing connection, blood lines not being looped loosely, or access site not being visible. And patient factors, it confuses the patient, pulling the needle out of the access. However, sensors should never replace an appropriate stepwise protocol to prevent venous needle dislodgement. This includes proper taping of access needle, adequate tightening of lower lock at all connections, and ensuring that all blood lines are loosely looped to prevent accidental dislodgement. The access site should always be examined whenever the venous pressure monitor suggests drop in pressure. And the most important measures are maintaining the access site visible at all times and keeping the high-risk patients close to the nurse station. Then comes allergic reactions during hemodialysis. And an allergic reaction during hemodialysis must be closely investigated because the exposure to the allergen may result in worse signs and symptoms and a poor outcome. Dogridas et al. In 1985 reported 21 severe allergic reactions to dialyzers in 260,000 dialysis sessions for a frequency of approximately one episode in 12,000 hemodialysis sessions to capramonium cellulose hemodialyzers. We get an allergic reaction to the dialyzer itself, or more commonly, the sterilizer, disinfectants, heparin, or other medications infused during the dialysis as antibiotics, blood products, or iron. Allergic reactions are classified as type A and type B. Type A allergic reactions occur within few minutes of hemodialysis initiation and present with pruritus, urticaria, bronchospasm, laryngeal edema, or anaphylactic shock. Type 2 reactions occur later in the dialysis session and are associated with less intense symptoms such as chest pain and back pain. Type A reactions are mediated through IgE, whereas type B reactions are complement mediated. Earlier dialyzers, which were composed of cellulose, activated the alternate complement pathway and were considered bioincompatible. Subsequent modifications added acetate side chain to cellulose to be added to OH molecule present on the surface of the cellulose, reducing complement activation, making dialyzers more biocompatible. At present, most centers use synthetic dialyzers, which are considered to be highly biocompatible. Synthetic dialyzers are composed of polyester sulfone, polysulfone, polyamide, or polyacrylonitrile. Sterilized with chemicals as ethylene oxide, steam sterilization, or radiation, gamma or beta. Ethylene oxide has fallen out of favor due to its propensity to attach to the bonding compound of the dialyzer and to cause type A allergic reaction. Ethylene oxide mediates anaphylaxis through IgE-mediated hypersensitivity, whereas dialyzer components typically activate complement or bradykinin. Tillman et al. Reported 5 cases of anaphylactoid reaction to acrylonitrile 69 AN69 dialyzers occurring within minutes of hemodialysis initiation in patients on an angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor. This reaction is mediated by bradykinin rather than IgE, histamine, or complement. The negatively charged moiety of AN69 during contact phase with blood may activate Hagman factor factor 12, leading to bradykinin formation. ACE inhibitors also inhibit kinase, an enzyme which inactivate bradykinin, thereby further increasing plasma bradykinin level and producing hypotension and angioedema in absence of urticaria. Ban membranes pre-treated with positively charged polyethylamine are associated with markedly reduced bradykinin activation. Patients on ACE can now be safely dialyzed with AN69 dialyzers that are surface-treated with polyethylamine. Heparin also may result in heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, and 5% of patients with HIT develop allergic reactions characterized by nausea, cough, fever, and chills. Additional clinical features include hypertension initially, transient global amnesia, and profuse diarrhea. HIT-associated allergic reaction is mediated by IgG rather than IgE. Some measures to minimize an allergic reaction to a dialyzer: prime the dialyzer well, switch from ethylene oxide sterilization to gamma or steam sterilization of the dialyzer. In the event of a hypersensitivity reaction, don't return the blood to the patient because this may aggravate the allergic reaction. Treat with antihistaminics, corticosteroids, and epinephrine for a hypersensitivity reaction, and rule out other conditions that may simulate an allergic reaction, as air embolism, hemolysis, and biogenic reactions. Intravenous iron is more effective than oral iron in raising hemoglobin in hemodialysis population. It is administered to approximately 70% of patients on hemodialysis each month. Adverse drug events to intravenous iron were estimated at 94 per million intravenous dose in 1998 to 2000, decreased to 38 per million by 2001 to 2003, after a switch to safer formulations. The rate of fatal adverse drug events was highest for higher molecular weight dextran, 11.3 per million, intermediate for lower molecular weight dextran, 3.3 per million, and the lowest for sodium ferric gluconate, 0.9 per million, and iron sucrose, 0.6 per million. Minor adverse reactions can occur with any intravenous iron preparation, but severe life-threatening reactions are rare. Minor symptoms such as pruritus, flushing, mild chest discomfort, arthralgia, myalgia, and nausea usually abate with the cessation of the infusion, and it can be restarted at a lower rate after symptoms resolve. If patients develop urticaria, then infusion should be stopped and the patient should be observed. Restarting the infusion after treatment with steroids may be considered after symptoms resolve. A more severe reaction may present with severe chest pain, persistent hypotension, and cough, and it may warrant stopping the infusion and treating with steroids and epinephrine. Pre-medication with steroids should be considered in patients at risk of developing a reaction, as in history of inflammatory arthritis, multiple drug allergies, or severe asthma. Diphenhydramine should be avoided as a pre-medication because it may cause symptoms similar to minor reactions and be falsely interpreted as an adverse effect. A life-threatening reaction, stridor, wheezing, periorbital edema, or symptomatic hypotension to intravenous iron infusion preclude future iron infusion. Intravenous iron is contraindicated, of course, in the first trimester of pregnancy and could be used with caution during second and third trimester. An allergic-like reaction during dialysis may result from medications as heparin, blood products, intravenous iron, antibiotics, and other medications. Heparin, we measure IgE level, tryptase level at 1 hour, 24 hours, and 36 hours. Heparin IgG-mediated antibody to platelet factor 4 and the platelet count. Intravenous iron, also tryptase level at 1 hour, 24 hours, and 36 hours to document anaphylaxis. Anaphylaxis due heparin, we can consider another anticoagulant, as enoxaparin or heparin can be used instead of heparin as an anticoagulant for patients on dialysis. If it is related to dialysis, agents as dialysis membrane or sterilant as serine oxide, also total IgE can be measured, serum eosinophil count, tryptase test, allergic reaction is treated by stopping dialysis and don't return extracorporeal blood as mentioned before. Prime dialyzer well, use polysulfone with different housing compound. For differential diagnosis, biogenic reaction, air embolism, and hemolysis. Vascular access hemorrhage is uncommon but potentially fatal complication if not recognized promptly and acted on with an appropriate intervention. Most fatal vascular access hemorrhages occur outside dialysis facility, but occasionally they rupture at dialysis unit. Any rapidly enlarging pseudoaneurysm, evidence of outflow stenosis by arm elevation test, failure to collapse, high pitch per week, thinning or ulceration of skin over pseudoaneurysm, pulsatility, or evidence of infection should prompt urgent intervention. Proper cannulation technique may prevent pseudoaneurysm formation. Rope ladder technique prevent aneurysm formation, whereas repeated cannulation of the same area may promote aneurysm formation. If the aneurysm is stable without evidence of imminent rupture, ulceration, thinning or shiny skin, or infection, then referral should be made for a fistulogram to evaluate for potential underlying outflow stenosis. Angioplasty to decrease intra-access pressure may prevent aneurysm formation or slow its growth. Physical examination of an aneurysm is the most important tool to determine the need for an intervention. This aneurysm is about to rupture from ulceration, thin overlying skin, and cannulation in this area should be avoided till angioplasty or appropriate measures are taken. In the event of bleeding from vascular access site, the most important point is direct continuous pressure with a finger for 15 to 20 minutes. This is the most effective method of controlling bleeding. In the event of rupture of a pseudoaneurysm away from dialysis unit or hospital, direct pressure with a finger at site of bleeding is the best method of controlling bleeding. Patients should be advised to continue holding direct pressure until emergency medical help arrives and avoid applying a tourniquet, towel, or blood pressure cuff to the extremity. For emergencies related to water treatment system, at first, we shall give you an idea about water treatment system. We have two major types of water purification systems in common use. The first one, and the more common, is a reverse osmosis, and the second one is the ionizer. To protect and prolong the lives of reverse osmosis membranes, reverse osmosis membrane and deionizer resin, water goes through several steps of pretreatment. The first component of the pretreatment system is a sediment filter. This sediment filter will help to remove sediments such as clay. The water next passes through a carbon filter, and this carbon filter contains activated charcoal. This activated charcoal will remove chloramine from water. And then water will pass through a softener which contains resin, and this resin will lead to exchange of calcium and magnesium in exchange for sodium chloride. Then water will pass through the membrane, the small micropores of the RO membrane under a high pressure. These micropores of the RO membrane will prevent sodium chloride molecule from passing through, and water only will pass through this RO membrane. After that, the water will be exposed to ultraviolet light and bacterial filter to remove all bacteria and the biogens from water before being used for dialysis. The deionizer contains hydrogen ion and OH ion. Hydrogen ion will change for magnesium and calcium ions and sodium chloride and the OH ion will be exchanged for chloride, fluoride, and ammonia. This is a standard of water quality for dialysis. It should be revised individually for each one of these substances. The emergencies related to dialysis water system include acute water loss in a dialysis unit, which is an emergency actually. It may be localized due to breakage in water pipes in dialysis unit only, or represent a hospital-wide problem. Patients on in-center hemodialysis are exposed to about 200 liter water during an average dialysis session, and with the dialysis membrane being the only barrier between the dialysate and the blood, it is critical that municipal water undergo rigorous purification before its use during the dialysis. Biogenic reactions during a dialysis session may be due to multiple causes, including infection from various sources, water dialysate bacterial contamination, should be considered if there is cluster of similar events. Chloramine and the chlorine are removed by primary and secondary carbon tanks of the dialysis water system. Chloramine may cause hemolysis and methemoglobinemia in patients on dialysis due to exhaustion of carbon tanks or excess load of chloramine in situ water exceeding capacity of carbon tanks. Thus, total chlorine, which is a sum of free chlorine and bound chlorine, chloramine, is measured from both carbon tanks every 4 hours. The total chlorine level should be 0.1 part per million. Methemoglobinemia usually manifests as cyanosis and chocolate brown color blood in the tubing and a saturation gap. This saturation gap is a gap calculated from arterial blood gas, which is higher than that measured by pulse oximetry. The diagnosis is confirmed by direct methemoglobin measurement, an outbreak of fluoride toxicity leading to severe pruritus, headache, and cardiac arrest has been reported. It was found that an exhausted resin of deionizer was releasing fluoride into water. Fluoride, which is an anion, binds to calcium and magnesium and lower their serum level. Additionally, it may cause hyperkalemia by its action on the sodium-potassium ATPase pump and indirectly causing efflux of potassium from cell. Dialysis-associated hypoxemia is now a rare complication. It was common during acetate-containing dialysis solution, less common with bicarb-containing dialysis solution, results from neutrophil sequestration in pulmonary capillary bed. Cardiovascular disease in dialysis patients. Of course, cardiovascular disease is the most common complication and the chief cause of death in patients with end-stage renal disease, accounting for 45% to 50% of cause of death in end-stage renal disease patients. In end-stage renal disease patients, mortality due to cardiovascular disease is around 10 to 30 times higher than in general population. The traditional risk factors include age, sex, smoking, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and diabetes. And the non-traditional risk factors, among others, include endothelial dysfunction, inflammation, vascular calcification, chronic volume overload, anemia, inflammation, oxidant stress, hyperhomocysteinemia. The cardiovascular complications include arrhythmias of any type as a result of left ventricular hypertrophy, ischemic heart disease, electrolyte imbalance, potassium, calcium, phosphorus, and hydrogen ion, cardiomyopathy, cardiac tamponade, hypertension, angina pectoris, infective endocarditis, intracranial hemorrhage, and hypotension. Intradialytic hypertension occurs as from overestimation of the dry weight, decrease in potassium. Decreased potassium may stimulate renin, use of dialyzable antihypertensive medications, calcium level fluctuations, sympathetic stimulation, presence of native kidneys, and use of EPO. Pre-dialysis systolic pressure more than 140 millimercury or diastolic more than 90 millimercury when the patient is believed to be at so-called dry weight. This usually measured before the dialysis midweek dialysis session. The drug therapy goal, arterial pressure goals, should be established individually, taking into account age, comorbid conditions, cardiac function, and neurologic status. In patients with raised systolic and diastolic pressure and a few background cardiovascular complications, a reasonable pre-dialysis blood pressure goal is less than 130/80 millimercury, that targeted by GNC7 for patients with chronic renal disease. In patients with isolated systolic hypertension and wide pulse pressure, usually elderly patients with atherosclerotic complications, excessive lowering of blood pressure may be hazardous, and for them, a target pre-dialysis systolic pressure of about 140 to 150 millimercury is prudent. The treatment targets differ according to method of measurement of blood pressure. For home blood pressure less than 135 over 85 millimercury, 24-hour ambulatory blood pressure monitor less than 130/80, or median intradialysis blood pressure less than 140 over 90. Treatment, of course, at first sodium and fluid restriction, longer and or more frequent longer dialysis session. In some end-stage renal disease patients, irregular dialysis schedule 3 times per week using 4 hour session lengths will be insufficient to maintain euvolemia. And in such patients, the choices are to increase the dialysis session lengths or to switch to four times per week or even to daily dialysis. Antihypertensive drug use. The regular antihypertensive drugs in maintenance hemodialysis patients include angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitor or angiotensin receptor blocker, calcium channel blocker, beta receptor blocker, alpha receptor blocker, or sustained release nitrates. The most common arrhythmia which occur in dialysis patients is paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. It is one of the most common tachyarrhythmias in maintenance hemodialysis patients. Paroxysmal atrial fibrillation attack not only can affect the dialysis to proceed smoothly, but also it can increase death risk in maintenance hemodialysis patients. In the DOPS, which analyzed 37 or more participants in 12 countries in the dialysis outcome and practice pattern study to explore the association of the following practices with sudden death due to cardiac arrhythmias, cardiac arrest and or hyperkalemia, treatment time less than 210 minutes, QT over V less than 1.2, ultrafiltration volume more than 5.7 of the post dialysis weight, low dialysate potassium less than 3 milli equivalent per liter, and the prescription of QT interval prolonging drugs, indicating that identified modifiable dialysis practices associated with higher risk of sudden death, including short treatment time, large ultrafiltration volume, and low potassium in dialysate. Because low potassium in dialysate is potassium in dialysate less than 3 milli equivalent per liter is common and easy to change, tailoring may prevent some sudden cardiac deaths. Individualized interventions may effectively reduce paroxysmal atrial fibrillation attack during dialysis and maintenance hemodialysis patients. The general individualized intervention in maintenance hemodialysis patients are individualized dialysis programs such as increasing dialysis or hemodiafiltration frequency, or be changed to daily dialysis for atrial fibrillation with frequency, regular monitoring of serum potassium level before and after dialysis, adjusting dialysate concentration of potassium ions in a timely manner, use different prescription of individualized dialysate for hemodialysis treatment, closely monitor patients' vital signs during dialysis such as heart rate, blood pressure, and pulse rate, control interdialytic weight gain, strict volume policy including salt restriction and adequate ultrafiltration is fundamental to reach normovolemia and normotension, together with regression of left atrial hypertrophy in patients on hemodialysis. Avoid rapid shift in electrolytes, calcium, magnesium, and potassium. Prevent excessive increase in serum potassium between dialysis sessions. Patients on digitalis should be dialyzed against higher potassium dialysate. Avoid using higher dialysate glucose, reduce dialysate bicarbonate, reduce rate of ultrafiltration, and reduce rate of decline in serum osmolality. Treat hypotension and arrhythmias during dialysis aggressively. For hypotension associated with dialysis, chronic persistent hypotension, and intradialytic hypotension. It may be caused by volume-related factors, rapid ultrafiltration gain, inaccurate dry weight, low dialysate sodium, cardiovascular-related factors as arrhythmia, ischemia, decreasing cardiac reserve, vasoconstriction failure, high dialysate temperature, autonomic neuropathy, acetate buffer, antihypertensive drugs, eating during sessions, variable causes, cardiac tamponade, septicemia, dialyzer reaction, and air embolism. The sequelae of frequent intradialytic hypotension, volume overload due to suboptimal ultrafiltration, left ventricular hypertrophy, and interdialytic hypertension. faceless thrombosis may occur, increased in mortality and morbidity. The treatment, emergency treatment, is to stop and decrease rate of ultrafiltration, Trendelenburg position, decrease blood flow rate, intravenous bolus of normal saline, give nasal O2, peripheral agents, discontinue dialysis if no response to the above measures. To prevent accurate setting of the dry weight, minimize interdialytic weight gain, steady constant ultrafiltration, increase dialysate sodium concentration, bicarbonate dialysate buffer, temperature control, improvement in cardiovascular performance, midodrine among patients with autonomic neuropathy, avoidance of food ingestion during the dialysis, no antihypertensive medications prior to dialysis treatment. The 2007 European Best Practice Guidelines in Hemodialysis recommended the following stepped approach for prevention of intradialytic hypotension. First-line approach include dietary counseling, sodium restriction, no food intake during dialysis, clinical dry weight reassessment, bicarbonate as a dialysis buffer, dialysate temperature of 36.5 degrees centigrade, and/or appropriate dosing and timing of antihypertensive agents. Second line approach include objective methods to assess dry weight, as in body composition monitoring, cardiac evaluation, gradual reduction of dialysate temperature from 36.5, the lowest 35, consideration of blood volume control, the feedback, increase in dialysis time and or frequency, or use of high dialysate calcium concentration. The third line approach, if other treatment options have failed, the guidelines recommend the third line approach, which involve consideration of midodrine or L-carnitine supplementation or shift to peritoneal dialysis. Chest pain and back pain, sometimes associated with mild, it may be mild and non-specific, may be associated with hypotension, disequilibrium syndrome, more serious complications as angina, acute coronary syndrome, hemolysis, air embolism, pulmonary embolism, dissecting aortic aneurysm. The presence of cardiovascular disease is an important predictor of mortality in patients with end-stage renal disease. Angina is the commonest presentation of coronary heart disease in dialysis units. Frequent episodes of hypotension during hemodialysis may be the presentation of coronary artery disease, and exertional dyspnea, intradialytic or interdialytic, sudden cardiac arrest or death, and arrhythmias are less common presentations. For patients whose angina manifests primarily during hemodialysis session, a number of therapeutic options available. Nasal oxygen should be given routinely. If the angina episode is associated with hypotension, then initial treatment should include raising blood pressure by elevating the feet and by cautiously administering normal saline. Sublingual nitroglycerin can be given as soon as the pressure has increased to a clinically accepted value. Consideration should be given to reducing the blood flow rate and stopping ultrafiltration until the episode subsides. Pre-dialysis administration of sublingual nitrates may be of benefit when applied 1 hour before hemodialysis session, assuming that the blood pressure will tolerate this intervention. Acute coronary syndrome is an extremely poor prognosis in dialysis patients with an acute myocardial infarction, and this may be in part to a relatively increased number of atypical clinical presentations resulting in underdiagnosis and undertreatment. As an example, the presence of dyspnea alone due to an acute myocardial infarction in an individual scheduled to undergo a regular chronic dialysis procedure may be mistakenly attributed to volume overload. There is extremely poor prognosis in dialysis patients with acute myocardial infarction. In addition, baseline abnormalities on the electrocardiogram, such as left ventricular hypertrophy, may mask characteristic change with ischemia. Pulmonary embolism is also an extremely uncommon in dialysis patients during hemodialysis session and may be observed after manipulation of a thrombus or occlusion of the dialysis access. Pericarditis, which may be viral, bacterial, mycobacterial, or maybe from under dialysis, it may be hemodynamic, patients may be hemodynamically stable. In this case, you intensify dialysis till resolution of the uremic pericarditis. Signs of tamponade, enlarging effusion or unchanged effusion, may need a pericardiotomy or pericardiectomy. In unstable hemodynamics, signs of tamponade and signs of tamponade, then pericardiocentesis should be performed immediately and after pericardiotomy or pericardiectomy electively. The evidence of cardiac tamponade is suspected by hypotension refractory to fluid resuscitation and vasopressors, descended neck veins with cyanosis, central venous pressure more than 20 millimercury, narrowed pulse pressure, no other explanation of hypotension. Pericardiocentesis should be limited to selective cases, and this fluid, pericardial fluid, will be subjected to cytologic evaluation to discriminate a bacterial, traumatic, neoplastic, or idiopathic cause. Removal of chronic pericardial effusion, which may also produce immediate clinical improvement. Placement of a catheter for repeated pericardial drainage and lavage. Installation of antimicrobial agents into pericardial space. Suspicion of purulent pericarditis. Contraindications, septic pleurites, external wound overlying site of pericardiocentesis. Thrombocytopenia less than 50,000 per cubic millimeter, bleeding disorder, and anticoagulant therapy for elective pericardiocentesis. Muscle cramps is a prolonged inflammatory muscle contraction that occur in a muscle which voluntarily contracts when it is already in its most shortened position. Cramps tend to occur most frequently near the end of hemodialysis treatment, most commonly involve muscles of lower extremity, but may muscles of hand, arm, and abdomen may also be affected. Cramps may occur often in older non-diabetic anxious patients, low BTH and high serum creatine phosphokinase. Concentrations are also more frequent among patients with dialysis-associated muscle cramp. The etiology of hemodialysis-associated muscle cramp may be plasma volume contraction, hyponatremia, tissue hypoxia, hypomagnesemia, carnitine deficiency, elevated serum leptin level. The treatment is reversal of low blood pressure, hypertonic saline or dextrose, triple saline, or 50% dextrose are equally effective. Hypertonic saline may be preferred among those with volume depletion. Hypertonic dextrose may be the better therapeutic option in non-diabetics because it does not adversely affect salt and water balance, local massage of the affected muscle, and the application of moist heat. To prevent, minimize interdialytic weight gains, prevention of dialysis-associated hypotension, higher dialysate sodium concentration, carnitine supplementation, quinine sulfate, vitamin E. Fever and chills may occur. You should seek for the source of infection. Special consideration should be given to vascular access. Infection control practice should be followed in hemodialysis unit. At the end, I will end my talk by a short lines of management of hyperkalemia. As a subject of hyperkalemia, we need a lecture in itself. Calcium chloride and calcium gluconate will act immediately and antagonize cell excitation and duration of action from 30 to 60 minutes. Insulin, 10 unit regular insulin intravenously with 25% dextrose, beta 2 agonist by inhalation, sodium bicarbonate, furosemide for patients with urine output adequate, and oral sodium polystyrene sulfonate. The root cause analysis after an adverse event. Any adverse event, whether it has occurred, has the potential to occur, or was averted by appropriate intervention, requires a thorough investigation to identify its root cause. all dialysis units must have protocols for reporting such events and taking appropriate measures towards root cause analysis. Any adverse event during a dialysis, stabilization of the patient, inform physician and medical director, inform unit supervisor, sequester hemodialysis machine and its components, inform biomedical team for inspection, safe tubing needle and dialyzer, draw dialysate fluid for culture and content, review policies and reinforce education, modify policies and the protocols as needed, a multidisciplinary team, all these root cause analysis will help to prevent any adverse events during dialysis. And thank you. I think I ended my talk, and I hope it was not too long for you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Montasser, for this very illustrative. It is very comprehensive, a lot of points, so the discussion will be very difficult. For me, just a few points I'm going to highlight. I like your statements about the ear fistula to be uncovered, because we witnessed a couple of cases at the Urology and Nephro Center since a long time. The patient, there was dislodgement of the needle from the vein, and then bleeding occurs, and the fistula was covered, and then we find the blood on the ground. So the patient was treated with blood transfusion and was secured. From that point of time, since more than 20 years, the policy in the center is to uncover the limb having the fistula. So, and it is included in the emergency management of the nurse care of hemodialysis patients. So this is a very nice statement. And when I visited France on 2000, the year of 2000, there was a case of catastrophic end from fistula-related needle dislodgement. Another point I would like to stress, if we decide to have CT with contrast, CT with contrast should be scheduled before dialysis for patients on maintenance hemodialysis, so long as it is elective. Why? Because iodinetic contrast includes a large amount of iodide that accumulates if the patient is not dialyzed, and increase the amount of iodide in the blood after injecting iodinated contrast may lead to iodide idiosyncratic reaction, including salivary gland enlargement, skin rash, even back pain from pancreatitis. So it is known as iodide mumps. So to be careful about this point. We shouldn't put the needle in the same place every time. This is for the Charby needle, as you mentioned. And if we use a buttonhole, the needle should be blunt-ended in the same place. But for the Charby needle, if we puncture the vein in the same site every session, this will increase the risk of pseudoaneurysm formation. I'd like to say a case I found when I visited Rwanda since a couple of years. There was a case inside the hemodialysis. The patient complained of septic arthritis, and they drained the septic arthritis, and then septic arthritis recurred many times. The cause was dialysis through catheter. So to bottom mind, if there is septic arthritis, osteomyelitis, endocarditis, all these are indications to remove the catheters. Septic arthritis will not be cured except if the catheter is removed. Hypoglycemia, this is one of the complications to be mentioned, because we may witness fatal hypoglycemia in diabetic patients. Regarding digoxin, I recommend against the use of digoxin in dialysis patient altogether, because the risk of potassium, because we use dialysate bath of potassium 2, and this will lead to digitalis intoxication. A lot of complication related to fistula and the eye. So I'd like to stop here because of the long comment and to leave the discussion for the professors and the attendees. Anyone wants to ask any question, please raise your hand. Dr. Saeed Khamis.
Good evening, Dr. Hussein. Thanks, Dr. Montasser, for this elegant presentation. I have a few comments just because I know, as Dr. Hussein said, it is a long story, this emergencies during dialysis. One lecture cannot be enough, but mashallah, you covered almost all of them. Number one, just I would like to warn our colleague to be careful on looking at all the machines at the beginning of all dialysis sessions during their routine round, because unfortunately some, not all, some of the nurses put the machine on the preparation position or preparation. That means no alarm. No alarm means a disaster, a catastrophe. So we should be careful of this issue, number one. Number two, we should not ignore that the most important time to closely monitor our patient is during initiation of the session and during and after, immediately after the termination of the session, because most of the complication can occur during this time. For example, post dialysis, the patient is hyperemized, old age, atherosclerotic. He can maybe hypotension. He can fall down, have subdural hematoma, leading to progressive headache after that. So we should be careful of this. Number three, I face, as Dr. Hussein said, some patients with advanced chronic liver disease, and during the last hour of dialysis, they develop hepatic coma. They are on the borderline, but because of the severe hypokalemia or the hypokalemia occurring during dialysis, they develop hepatic coma. We correct this by raise the potassium path in the dialysis. Another complication is a recurrent abdominal pain during dialysis, especially in the last 1 or 2 hours, due to non-obstructive intestinal ischemia. So we should discuss this with what's called the vascular surgeon, and we should manipulate in dialysis, decrease the ultrafiltration. We should not allow the patient to go into hypotension. So abdominal pain also, it can be a complication during the dialysis, and mesenteric ischemia should be ruled out in this patient. The most important issue is the medications. We should not be over enthusiastic adding a problem to the already existing problem. We used to give the medications for sure post dialysis, and most of the medications have a unique problem in our patients. For example, if I'm giving ciprofloxacin IV, can lead to convulsion in such a patient. Also, flagyl, some third generation cephalosporin leading to metabolic encephalopathy.
Okay, Dr. Saeed, this is a very valuable point, because the heart in the hemodialysis patients is very fragile. There is a lot of calcification. This all drugs can lead to catastrophes in hemodialysis patients if these drugs are not indicated. For example, ciprofloxacin may lead to arrhythmia. So we shouldn't prescribe medicine except if they are extremely indicated. I agree with you, Professor Saeed, for all these points, but...
just one point, Dr. Hussein, if you allow me. The dialyzable anticonvulsant medication, we should be careful also, they can lead to convulsion during the dialysis sessions. And thank you so much, Dr.
Hussein. Thank you very much, Professor Saeed. You remind me by hyperkalemia. For Dr. Montasser, if the patient is in dialysis, and we have hyperkalemia, the treatment is to do dialysis again and again. And if we decide to give temporary measures like what you mentioned in the slide of hyperkalemia, just to pay time until the hemodialysis machine is ready. I want to hear from you about this point, Professor Montasser.
Actually, the proper treatment for hyperkalemia is dialysis. And actually, I recommend if a patient with severe hyperkalemia to prolong the dialysis session time for a long time, not for 4 hours, to be extended to 6 hours or even 8 hours to guard against the rebound the hyperkalemia.
Okay. I don't like to proceed in my comment.
We can start by medications at first. till preparation of the machine, as yes. you said, and then we start the dials.
I prefer not to prolong the discussion in hyperkalemia because Professor Hisham said in Tuesday, I think he will discuss the kinetic of potassium. I'm not going to discuss potassium anymore. And I'd like to hear from Professor Hisham, then Dr. Tarantong. Professor Hisham.
Thank you very much, Professor Montasser. Dr. Montasser, one of the senior reviewer in Egyptian first Egyptian hemodialysis guidelines. واحنا نفخر بكده ان هو كان اسمه موجود معانا وراجع الكتاب الكامل للهيموداليس جايد لاينز وفي سيكشن الستاندرد اوبريتنج بروسيدجرز لكل الكومبليكيشنز اللي ممكن تحصل في الدياليسيس ان بريف فانا بشكره طبعا على المحاضره المجمعه انا ليا بس تلي مسجز كده سريعه هبتدي بالهايبركاليميا لان اسرتها جت طبعا مش هخش في الديتيلز في الكاينتكس لكن هو النقطه ان هو البوتاسيوم هاندلنج مع الدارس بيشن مشكله كبيره جدا عندي فيري نارو سبيس اتحرك فيه لا العيان يجي ببوتاسيوم قليل ولا العيان يجي ببوتاسيوم عالي بمعنى اخر ايه ان هو افضل ليفل للعيان اللي هو البوتاسيوم ما بين 4 4.5 قبل الدارسس وما يزيدش عن 5.5 بقى قبل الدياليسيس مباشره يعني ما بين 4 ل 5.5 وده ريز نقطه مهمه جدا للديبيت او للديسكشن ليتر على الفاليو للكاتاين اكسشينج ريزنز في عيان الاون دياليسيس اللي كل مره بيجي له بوتاسيوم 6.5 هنحط عليها كوتش مارك اتوسط في الدوبس واتوسط في حتت ثانيه كتير بس دي شود بي كونسيدر في العينين اللي هم بيرزيستنتلي بيجوا بوتاسيوم اكتر من 5.5 بري داس هعمل كومنت سريع على دكتور منتصر ادينج فاليو من شغلي انا من الريسيرش على موضوع الهيموليسيس الهيموليسيس از فيري كومن ولو حطيته مع المايكرو بابلز المايكرو بابلز مينينج ذات انها في المايكروميتر دايامتر اللي هي ممكن تعدي من الهيموديالز ماشينز من غير الارم وليه علاقه بالبالمونري هايبرتنشن اللي بيحصل في العينين الاند ستيج رينال ديزيز لو حطيت المايكرو بابلز بالهيموليسيس هقول لك الديفكت دايما بيجي من بلاد تيوبنج ناخد بالنا منها جدا بالذات الرولينج بامب لازم الماتيريال والفيتنج بتاعها يبقى كويس اعرف منين ان في هيموليسيس مايلد هيموليسيس او مينيمال هيموليسيس انا بعمل اختبار لطيف جدا ورخيص جدا بناخد سامبل من البلاد فري هيموجلوبين على التوتال هيموجلوبين للعيان ده بنسميه الهيموجلوبين 3 هيموجلوبين اندكس او الهيموليسيس اندكس دي سهله جدا وبتتعمل في الكومن للعيانين كتير لان ساعات التيربلنس ايفن اوف فلو من الكاثر او الفيستول او البلاد تيوبنجز بيعمل مايلد هيموليس المايكرو بابلز مهمه كمان لانها في ستادز انها بتزود الاحتياج للايسادوسيس يعني المايكرو بابلز ممكن تعمل بالمر هايبرتنشن ممكن تعمل لي مور كومبليكيشنز وانفلاميشن وممكن يبقى محتاج ان العين يزود الايسادوس عشان كده ريسنتلي خلال الاربع خمس سنين اللي فاتوا ابتدى تظهر بلاد تيوبنجز اسمها ايرلس بلاد تيوبنج يعني غير قابله انها تعمل المايكرو بابلز اخر كومنت هقوله على موضوع الالرجي لانه فيري فيري كومن في سبيسيفيك بيشنتس وساعات ما بقاش غالبا ما بقاش انسولين اوكسايد لان هو غالبا ما بقاش فيه انسولين اوكسايد لكن ده بيبقى ليه ريليشن اكتر للدياليسيس ممبرين ستابيليتي هنتكلم عليه ان شاء الله في الحلقه الرابعه من الهيموداليسيس بيسك لكن بيبقى فيري كومن للدياليسيس ممبرين اخر نقطه على البكتيريال فراجمنتس اللي بتعدي من الووتر تريتمنت يعني في حاجه بنسميها دي ان اي فراجمنتس بكتيريا دي ان اي فراجمنتس ودي اصغر من الاندوتوكسين يعني بتعدي من الاندوتوكسين فلتر وبالتالي الفريكوينت ديس انفكشن اوف ووتر تريتمنت ده اهم نقطه بلس الاندوتوكسين فلتر وطبعا اشكر تاني الدكتور منتصر اولا اشكره ان هو كان من الريفيور للجايد لاينز واشكره ثانيا على المحاضره القيمه والمعلومات الجيده التعليميه لكل الدكاترة والزملاء شكرا جزيلا
شكرا دكتور هشام انا في سؤال بس قبل ما الدكتور طارق يتكلم سؤال على الشاتنج هنا is decreasing the dialysate sodium of any value in patients with intradialytic hypotension انا بتهيألي الموضوع ده هنناقشه بعدين لكن احنا لو احنا هنتعامل مع الهايبوتنشن ما بنقللش الصوديوم في الدايلازيت ده بالعكس ده انا ممكن يبقى في كلام على ان ازود الصوديوم في الدايلازيت علشان افيس الهاي بوتنشن. لكن
فيها بلازما ريفيلينج دي اليوم الثلاث ان شاء الله
ان شاء الله. لكن الصوديوم بروفايلنج اللي كان موضه في وقت من الاوقات بقى تقريبا الوقت ما عادش حد بيستخدمه.
لا لا لا
دكتور طارق طنطاوي اتفضل.
سعيد جدا بالمحاضره الاستريتيف، وفعلا حضرتك يعني خدتنا في رحله جوه وحده الغسيل، حط الميه، كل الكومبليكيشنز اللي ممكن تحصل، ويعني رجعتنا للذكريات زمان. انا عايز اقعد حاجه بس مع الانترودكشن بتاع الفيستولا بتاع التيمبري فاسكولار اكسس، بالذات لو في ميني ترايلز واتيفر هي فيمورال او انترنال جاجولار، ممكن يحصل emergency. يعني انا كولد في ديوتي افترنون ديوتي كان ابرود، والبيشنت كان عنده سيفير هيماتوما الريليشن للفيمورال كاستر، وعرفنا في الهيستوري ان في ميني ترايلز وفي ارتيريال بانكشرز، وبعد كده بعد ما ان هم ركبوا الاسترال فيمورال فين ما عملوش البروبر كومبريشن وخلص الدياليسيس، وطبعا حضرتك عارف الهيبارين والستوري اللي بتحصل. Another story كانت برضو بس دي كانت داخلية هنا ما كانتش أبرود، وكانت عمل برضو multiple trials على الانترنال جاجر والبين رايت وليفت، واللي حصل بالضبط ان هو البيشنت طبعا كان فيه شوية هيماتومز يعني الى حد ما كانوا عاملين عليهم كومبريشن، لكن بعد ما خلص الفيرست دي على فكرة الاثنين كانوا فيرست هيموداياليسيس، برضو حصل يعني very huge هيماتوما في النك، وللأسف الشديد البيشنت ده باست ما كانش فيه، لأن طبعا عشان يتحط على فنتليتر ويتجهز ويتعمل حصل فيه مشكلة. فهم دول النقطتين أنا حبيت أضيفهم، لكن أنا مستمتع باللي أنت قلت يا دكتور منتصر، واستحملنا موضوع الزوم والحاجات دي، لكن المحاضرة فعلا ممتاز.
لا الـ الـ أنا بحيك
للتعليقات يعني بتاعت زملائي دكتور حسين ودكتور طارق. I would like to add ان من ناحية الفاسكولار اكسس، لو فرض ان واحد رايد ان هو يعمل بانكشر سواء اذا كان فيمورال او انترنال جوجلر او سب كليفين اند فيلد بانكشر، يبقى he has to يعمل هيموستيزيس before ان يعمل another trial for a puncture. الريتروبريتينيال هيماتوما اللي بتحصل مع الفيلد فيمورال كاسترايزيشن or after frequent trials is very serious، لانها ما بتكونش visible. يعني اذا عملت abdominal examination للعيان ممكن you can feel a retroperitoneal hematoma if it is huge and you can detect and diagnose. وطبعا confirmation of the diagnosis will be confirmed by ultrasound examination. برضو دي بتيجي نتيجة لفيلير اوف او ان في يترخف ان هو يعمل compression او good compression after venous puncture. وخصوصا بقى كمان لو كان حصل by mistake arterial puncture، يبقى في الحالة ده you can expect ان ممكن يحصل retroperitoneal hematoma. احب احكي عن حاجتين كومبليكيشنز حصلوا لي مع حالات من مده طويله، وعشان تو دايركت يور اتنشن للامبورتنس بتاع الحاجتين بتاعه انك انت يو هاف نوت تو كفر الفاسكولار اكسس. واحده منهم احنا عارفين زمان كنا بنشتغل بس ما كانش عندنا يعني انترنال جوجلر ولا سب كليفيان كاسترايزيشن، كان كل شغلنا بالفيمورال كاسترايزيشن، وكنا بنعمل يعني بايلاترال فيمورال فين كاسترايزيشن، كنا بنسحب من واحده وبنرجع في الثانيه. واكشوالي عيان كان اصلا يعني هيمودايناميكالي ستيبل وند يو كانت اكسبكت هيز ديث يعني. فبعدين وانا نايم الممرضه بعتت لي بتقول لي الحق العيان اتوفى. اتوفى ازاي يا بنتي، ده احنا يعني كل حاجه فيه مظبوطه يعني مفيش اي حاجه. برفع غطى العيان عشان اشوفه، لقيت الخمسة لتر بتوع العيان موجودين على السرير بين رجليه، عشان حصل ديسلوجمنت للفيمورال كاستر من البلاد لاين. فده يبين لك اهميه ان لازم you have to expose the vascular access سواء اذا كان بقى يعني من arterial venous vistula او كان من dialysis cast. دي حاجه. الحاجه الثانيه برضو once وانا بحاول اشيل برميكاس وانا في الاوبريتنج سيتر وبشيل البرميكاس بتاعه العيان حصل له بالمونري امبوليزم وهو على الترابيزه. طبعا هي was saved يعني, لكن انا بقول لك ان ممكن من البريزنس اوف ذا كاستر فور ا لونج تايم ممكن يكون في اراوند ايت في بلاد كلوت وممكن تعمل بالمونري امبوليزم على الرغم انك انت ما عملتش اي مانيبيليشن اكتر من
الاير امبوليزم. اكتر دكتور منتصر اير امبوليزم
لا لا وبرضه دكتور هشام زي ما دكتور منتصر بيقول كده
واير امبوليزم كومز لما تيجي تشيل كمان الكاستر حتى لو الدبل يومنت
لا في لكن الاكثر واقعيه هو البنطلون ثرومبس الكاستر بتبقى عليها ثرومبس من
اول عليها ثرومبس اراوند
وعشان كده احنا
بدأنا اكشولي بعد الموفمنت والريموفال اوف ذا كاستر ما فيش يعني 1 اور 2 مينتس كده ابتدى العيان يبقى ساينوزد وابتدى يبقى فيه المانيفيستيشنز بتاعت
عشان كده عودنا بنعمل ايكو كارديوجرام بنعمل ايكو كارديوجرام روتين قبل ما نشيل كاستر بقى لها فتره موجوده تحسبا لوجود ثرومبس طبعا
يعني دي فيري امبورتنت بوينت كونسيدريشن بيفور ريموفال اوف لونج انديولينج دايلسيس كاستر ان احنا نعمل ايكو كارديوجرافي تو ديتكت اذا كان في انتراميورال ثرومبس بريزنت في الرايت ايتر.
حصلت عندنا في وان بيشنت ومن بعدها ده الكلام ده من 20 سنه او اكتر ومن بعدها بقت روتين لو الكاستر موجوده بفتره ايكو كارديوجرام از مانداتوري بيفور ريموفال اوف ذا كاستر عشان قصه البنطلون ثرومبس. موضوع طبعا الاير ساعات بيحصل كراكس في الكاستر فنخلي بالنا وما نيجي نسحب بالسرنجه تلاقي طلع هواء تعرف ان فيها خرم القسطره ديت فنبقى كيرفول قوي في القصه دي.
انا اتذكر استاذ من اساتذتي من اكتر من 30 سنه وبيعلمنا كان قال لي جمله لسه في دماغي لغايه دلوقتي قال لي if you want to discover you must uncover.
تمام
في اي حاجه في الدنيا. فالجمله دي فعلا تنطبق على موضوع البلاد ليك والديسلوجمنت للفيستولا والاخره وحاجات كتير طبعا في الميدسن يعني. لكن فعلا موضوع ان هو انكفرنج والعيان اللي بيحط الغطاء على راسه وايده وبتاع اللي احنا بنشوفها في المراكز دي حتى لو جاله هايبوتنشن مش هتشوفه.
شود بي بروهيبيتد. شود بي
طبعا طبعا.
السؤال اللي انا كنت قلته هو كان مكتوب انتراداليتك هايبرتنشن تقليل الصوديوم عشان انتراداليتك هايبرتنشن. بالنسبه للصوديوم والهايبو والهايبرتنشن انا البروفايلنج ده فقد الفيفر بتاعه لكن من الحكمه انه انا لو انا عارف العيان ها على الهايبوناتريميك سايد هزود دياليزات صوديوم 2 ملي مول عن الـ ده من كاكسبيرت اوبينيون عن السيرم صوديوم. ولو هو العكس يعني لو عنده هايبرتنشن هقلل الصوديوم في الدياليزات 2 ملي مول عن السيرم صوديوم بتاع العيان. لكن ان انا العب في الصوديوم كتير ما يعني الكلام ده بقى اوت اوف فيفر. في هنا سؤال طويل مبعوث وده سؤال للدكتور منتصر. عيان اندستيجنال ديزيز بيشنت ميزد تو سيشنز during the next session after 3 hours البيشنت ستارت تو فوميت سلر سبيتش كونفيوجن وبعد كده هل ده ديسكيورم سيندروم وهل الديسكيورم سيندروم بيجي في كرونيك بيشنتس؟ دكتور منتصر ترد على النقطه دي.
هو الديسيكوليبرام سيندروم كان اوكير ان كرونيك كيدني ديزيز بيشنتس
هيموديالايسيس.
هو طبعا يعني ليس كومن مع الكرونيك بيشنتس لكن لو البلاد بري دايلسيس بلاد يوريا ناتجن اور بلاد يوريا از فيري هاي دايلسيس ديسيكوليبرام سيندروم كان اوكير. سو اف ذا بيشنت از اوميتنج دايلسيس سيشن 1 اور 2 سيشنز you have to start gradually by increasing the blood flow rate gradually dialysate flow in the same range. This will help to prevent disequilibrium syndrome. Also dialysis session length should be يعني not more than 3 to 4 hours if the patient is omitted few dialysis sessions.
هو طبعا omitting session ده risk factor للديسيكليبريا ما فيش كلام. في سؤالين على الصوديوم انا هاجب واحد واسيب لحضرتك الهايبرناتريم. بالنسبه للهايبوناتريم والعيان هايبوناتريمك اعمل له السيفست دايلس للهايبوناتريمك بيشنت اكوردنج للليفل اوف هايبوناتريم. لو هو سيفير هايبوناتريم سبوز مثلا لقينا التحليل 105 ولا 108 رقم قليل جدا اعمل ايه؟ العيان ده لايبل طبعا اخلي بالنا الرينال فيلير بارشلي بروتكتد من البونتين ميلونولايسيس ما هوش زي النورمال بيرسون لكن مش ابسوليوت بروتكتد. فعلشان كده the safest way العيان اللي هو severely hyponatremic هو CRRT لان CRRT هتعمل لي يعني smooth increase of serum sodium بدون ان العيان يخش في equilibrium syndrome. ما عنديش CRRT machine يبقى هعمل very short dialysis session هنزل الكوندكتيفيتي لاقل ما يمكن وبلاد فلو لاقل ما يمكن وبعدها اعيد الغسيل تاني وتالت لكن ما اعملش long session او adequate session في عيان هايبوناتريميك ده ممكن يدخله في بونتاين ميونولايسيس من الرابيد كوركشن للهايبوناتريمي. فيبقى اكوردنج للليفل اوف هايبوناتريمي الواحد يبقى كوشس السيف اس ار ار تي والثاني الابلايد البراكتيكال ان انا شورت سيشن بلود فلو قليل والدياليزيت صوديوم انزله لاقل مستوى يسمح البامب في الغالب 130 ملي مول بير لتر. لو هايبرناتريميا بقى 175 نعمل انا بتهيألي دي نبقى نسيبها نعمل
طبعا لو في هايبرناتريميا يعني اولا وي هاف تو دايجنوز يعني الكوز اوف هايبرناتريميا وفي نفس الوقت هل العيان كونشس ولا انكونشس. اذا كان العيان ده انكونشس يعني ممكن نركب له نيزوجاستريك تيوب وياخد ايفن ووتر ثرو نيزوجاستريك تيوب او ممكن ندي له هايبوتونيك سلاين انترافينوس وجراديوال كوركشن برضه للسيرم صوديوم. Actually لو العيان ده هو هيحتاج دايلسيس لو هو in addition to hypernatremia العيان ده على دايلسيس then برضو انا اميل ان احنا نعلي السيرم صوديوم في الكوندكتيفيتي في الدايلازيت عشان ما نعملش rapid reduction للسيرم صوديوم نخلي برضو الصوديوم في الكوندكتيفيتي على 145 اذا فرض ان العيان indicate for dialysis at the same time يعني in addition to hypernatremia.
بتهيألي I full agreement يا دكتور منتصر زي ما احنا في الهايبرناتريميا عاوز نرفع الصوديوم بالهواده
بالرحم
في الهايبرناتريميا
بس في الهايبرناتريميا برضه دكتور حسين ان احنا برضه نركز على موضوع الدايلوشنال فاكتور
تمام
يعني دي مهمه قوي يعني الالترا فلتريشن بيرسي ممكن يحسن الموضوع الهايبرناتريميا في عيانين الريجولار او مينتنس هيموداليس بيشنت
يعني ده في الغالب هيكون هايبر فوليميك هايبوناتريميا
هي المشكله
ويل هيلب بين كوركشن اوف سيرم صوديوم.
هو السؤال بتاعها عيان وقت جاي لك الغسيل وده ميعاد جلسته وجاي بسيفير هايبوناتريميا لكن لو انا هايبوناتريميا في ايرجنت سيتويشن والعيان اوفرلودد
لا لا ما برضه في مينتنس هيموداليسيس من هايبر سيفير هايبر فوليميا
تمام يعني ما مش هنعمل ديبيت لكن السيفست واي لو انا عاوز اعمل دياليسيس هو السي ار تي او ان انا اعمل دياليسيس سيشن
يعني الستريت ده برضه ابليكابل عشان السي ار تي اصلا مش ابليكابل في اغلب الاماكن لكن لو فلو لو فلو لو دايلازيت فلو
بس انا مش عاوز سليد برلونجد اصل
لا 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 لو فلو لو فلو لو فلو سليد تكنيك
يعني
لو فلو يعني
شورت سيشن
بس له فلو له فلو يعني
اصل كلمه سليد معناها اكستندد فاكستندد معناها ساعات كتيره لا انا هعمل لو فلو ساعتين
و ما هي زي ما بقول لك لو فلو لو فلو لو فلو بالظبط كده تعمل عشان تبقى ابليكابل لاكثر الناس يعني السي ار ار تي يعني مش هيبقى ابليكابل.
طيب جميل هناخد سؤال من الدكتور رمضان عرفه وبعد كده هنموف طبعا الاساتذه اللي معانا اللي عاوزين يعلقوا. دكتور رمضان
شكرا جزيلا دكتور حسين انا بشكر دكتور منتصر طبعا على المحاضره القيمه جدا 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 واشكره شكر خاص على النقطه اللي هو اشار اليها بالنسبه للكلورين انديوس هيموليسيس كنا كلنا نعتقد انها حاجه ثيوريتيكال جاست ريتن ان ذا تكست بوكس وذاوت اني ابليكابيلتي نوادايز لكن ستيل كان اوكي وي هاف ان بات ايفنت لايك ذيس اند ات انديوسد in our unit in our my hospital, and it induced severe chest pain. It was unnoticed then severe chest pain and raised the cardiac enzymes. The patient went to non-STEMI because of the acute hemolysis and this acute drop in hemoglobin. Then we investigated the case and we found the chlorine leakage in the RO RO unit.
أنا بشكرك أنت ذكرت الحالة ديت وإحنا كان عندنا طبعا دكتور حسين من الأزهر جيت دينا محاضرة على الهيموداليس إمرجنسيز وقلبها كلها داليزيت سايد. الهيموداليس السيمينار الهيموداليسيس السنة اللي فاتت نشروا برضو مشكلة المغنيسيوم ليك من من البايبز والبيشنس دخلوا في سيفير هايبر ماجنيزيميا وفاتاليتيز بعضه البيشن دايت. فيبقى اذا وعشان كده الجزء الاخير اللي الدكتور منتصر قاله الروت كوز اناليسيس ده هو مهم للغايه. لما الاقي مشكله واعمل لها الروت كوز وامنحها ده احسن حاجه. طبعا سعيد بالكومنت بتاعك دكتور رمضان.
شكرا جزيلا وشكرا جزيلا على
الكوبكس اللي انت اتفرجت. شكرا يا باشا ربنا يخليك. دكتور رياض الايفون انميوت انميوت التليفون يا باشا. طيب دكتور فيصل
مساء الخير.
مساء النور.
مساء الخير دكتور منتصر. It's excellent talk actually. You remind us was with the old, very old things which happened long time back. I think with a new machine, the lesson which I can you know just take it out from this lecture for our young colleague nephrologists, that they have to look carefully for the machine they chose for the dialysis. Because now by having volumetric control, sodium variation machine, this is very important things because it saves the patients. We have so many complications long time back, which is not existing now. But still there are a few things which can exist, which we cannot do anything like irretractable hypotension or hypertension, severe hypertension during dialysis, which sometimes we stuck with it and we cannot do many things even. Whatever you give any medication, still the blood pressure is very high. Maybe it is related to some prostaglandin or some other issue, but it could happen. It's still phenomena during dialysis also. It's very important thing, which can happen and can cause a problem for the patient and for yourself. You're stuck with the patient, you are dialyzing it, and then he develops severe steel phenomena and ischemia in the hand. And you are obliged to stop the dialysis because of that and to revise again the fistula and manipulated. There are many other things which we you know we are seeing it, and something which is old like the catheter problem, the catheter which kinked catheter which sometimes dislodged and go to the heart. This happened many times before, and sometimes you have to go through maybe some endoscopic things in order to take the catheter, the tip of the catheter out of the heart. This happened before, and also leakage from the catheter with air embolism. This is a common problem which could happen also during dialysis. Nowadays, these things are less, but still, as you mentioned, we have to look carefully to the patient. We have not to forget all of this complication which could happen in dialysis. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Fis. Dr. Professor Mahmoud Hamada. Okay, if anyone wants to add any comment, please raise your hand to just to unmute you. Dr. Mahmoud? Okay. Dr. Hisham, do you have anything? اوكي دكتور هشام اوكي دكتور منتصر يعني في الختام الحلقه دي طبعا حلقه كانت عظيمه جدا
منتظرينها
لان لخصت كل الكومبليكيشنز وارهقت نفسك معانا يعني إيه، لان لو انا مكانك كنت نقيت شويه حاجات وقلتهم، لان القصه لا تنتهي ابدا. لكن حضرتك جبت كله
كفر يعني
يا باشا
في تايتل يعني.
لكن طبعا بس ده ادى فكره على ان الكومبليكيشن لا تنتهي يعني. قبل ما انا هقفل
صحيح دلوقتي بقت قليله قوي عن زمان، لكن اكشوال ستيل كان هاب. واكشوال يعني الكومنت بتاع الدكتور فيصل شاهين من حيث ان في بارت اوف ذا كاستر سليب ذا انسايد هارت، اكشوالي ات هابند ويز مي يعني ان وان اوف ماي بيشنتس وانس بيفور بيكوز اوف باد مانيفاكتشرنج اوف ذا كاستر، بارت اوف ذا كاستر واز انسايد اند ذا تو لاينز تو اوتسايد. One of the caster happened with me, actually. We consulted cardiothoracic surgery and they removed it in operating theater. Actually, this complication happened before.
طيب حصل معك قبل كده جاد واير الدك كله وبعد كده ما عادش لاقيه؟ النقطة تانية أخيرة قبل ما نقفل.
دور على جاد واير بقى.
يعني قليل البخت. آخر نقطة إنه عيان الهيموداليسس المفروض أتعامل معها إنه سبيشال كيس، ما هوش جنرال بيشنت. يعني مثلا على سبيل المثال مانجمنت اوف اتريال فيبريليشن بالانتيكواجوليشن في الداليس بيشنت از ديبيتابل ايشو، وهنستخدم أي نوع الوارفارين مشاكله كتيرة. طب الأباكسيبان بدأ يستخدم اوف ليبل، لكن الأباكسيبان في آخر ترايل منشورة إنه زود البليدنج وما قللش الستروك في عيان الاف في الداليس بيشنت. فعشان كده الانتي كواجوليشن انديكيشن في داليس بيشنت از ريستريكتد للي هو الاكستريم انديكيتد انتي كواجوليشن ان اتريال فيبريليشن، مش اي اتريال فيبريليشن اديله انتي كواجوليشن في داليس بيشنت. فطبعا يونيك بوبوليشن بستريس معين، واحنا كنا خلينا جمله زمان بنقعد نرددها، يكفي ان البيشنت البلاط بتاعه بره علشان ابقى مستشعر الخطر الجسيم في التعامل مع الهيموداليس. انا في نهايه الحلقه دي بشكر الدكتور منتصر شكرا جزيلا على الوقت، وبشكر كل الساده الزملاء والاساتذه على الدسكشن السريه، وبشكر الدكتور فيصل معنا فتح الكاميرا اهوت، فلازم يبقى شكر خاص طبعا ودايما مع بعض ان شاء الله. بنشكركم جميعا، وان شاء الله هرفع الفيديو باكر صباحا باذن الله، ومع ونتقابل مع الدكتور هشام السيد يوم الثلاث الساعة 8 في الحلقة الثالثة في الهيموداليس برينسيبلز، واعتقد هيبقى فيها كلام على الكاينيتيك، كلام مهم جدا. انتظرونا الثلاث الساعة 8 ان شاء الله.
صباح الخير،
مع الف سلامة، مع سلامة الله. شكرا دكتور منتصر، الف شكر.